welcome to the Kevin and Nikee Show on iHeartRadio.
Overdose. It's time for the Kevin and Nikee Show. They gon' have it lit up. Yeah, you know, it's time for the Kevin and Nikee Show. They got the airwaves popping every city across the globe. It's time for the Kevin and Nikee Show. They gon' have it lit up. Yeah, you know, it's time for the Kevin and Nikee Show. They got the airwaves popping every city across the globe. You know him as a dope actor, Kevin D. Benton. 360 twice, Jim, how you keep winning? And you know the baddest actress, Nikee won. She so bad you walking past, she had you speaking foreign. If you ain't tuning in, this your reality check. You might miss out on your favorite star celebrity guest. When they celebrate, what you do? You get the bell, yeah. During Kevin's corner, get expired and encouraged, yeah. Bend them corners, why you listen, but don't swerve. Find out what's getting on Nikee nerves. What's bothering Nikee? What's bothering Nick Nick? What's bothering Nikee? What's bothering Nick Nick? Keep on playing. Me and Kevin Goons and we gon' get you hit. Yo, check us out on social media. In your mobile phone, we everywhere. You ever stations played out like a ringtone. Follow me like Beano R-E-M-E-Y. Beano Remy. Pop like Simi. And my flow hotter. Thick a semi. Been doing this since I scraped up pennies. But back to the subject, Kevin Nikee.
So we are back.
Yeah.
Happy New Year. Yeah, we want to wish everybody out there a Happy New Year on behalf of the Kevin and Nikee Show on iHeartRadio. And yeah, man, we are revved up and we are ready to go. We are, as Nikee would say, ready.
Yes.
Yeah, that's it, man. So yes. Yeah. So, yeah, man, it was New Year's. It was, mm-hmm. We had, of course, the Christmas season going into the New Year. A lot of rat racing out there. Mm-hmm. A lot of hustle and bustle out there. And then the New Year came. Now, a lot of stuff was shut down, mm-hmm. like the fireworks mm-hmm. and things like mm-hmm. that. You had to kind of do it on TV. You know, some people still found a way to get their party on. Liquor store lines was long.
Yes, it was.
They was very long, but people found a way to get their happiness on in their own happy way. And look, we ain't mad at you because 2020 was H-E-L-L. But listen, this year is going to be better.
Yes.
So, like, I remember how we used to go to church. They would always come up with some kind of rhyming slogan for the new year. So, yeah. What's the rhyming slogan for 2021?
Wow, I don't know.
Because it was we were on our way to heaven in 2011. It was, they will always come up with a rhyme. So I was like, we got to come up with a rhyme for 2021.
Yeah, put a pin in it.
We'll put a pin in it.
Put a pin in it. We're going to put our heads together and come up with something next week.
Because remember, we were going to win in 2010.
Yeah.
All that stuff. So we got to come up with something for 2021.
We were going to get some money in 2020. Now we got to
People lost money in 2020.
I know. Yeah. A whole lot of that didn't happen.
Yeah.
So we got to...
But we're going to have some fun in 2021?
Did it!
There we go.
There you go. We gotta make up for what we lost.
That's it.
We gotta make up for what we lost. But I'm telling you right now, we're gonna need more than $600 to do it. Hello. You ain't heard it from me.
I know, right? They need to, no pun intended, cut this out.
I'm saying?
Come on.
How you going to give out $1,200 in April of 2020 and then come back with $600 in December. What kind of crap is that? Something? But okay.
Anyway.
Okay. But anyway, that's why y'all need to vote.
That's it. That's it. You got to vote. You got to vote. Vote like your life depends
on it. That's right. Because it does.
So, you know, we always got a lot to talk about, a lot going on. So with that being said, it is now time for the many adventures of Kevin and Nikee.
All right. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, let me tell you, the new year was really good. It was really good and fun to a certain extent. My mama got upset a little bit.
What'd you get upset? What Mama Warren get upset about?
She got upset a little bit. Remember I told you that, you know, my brother and I, we had reconciled and different things like that. We were spending, you know, the new year and everything together. So she got upset because she called herself trying to, you know, do communion. Because, you know, she's a deaconess.
Yeah.
She called herself trying to do communion. And she poured out this wine, right?
Mm-hmm.
The problem is everybody drinks. Okay, in my
family. Oh, so they were inviting that communion.
She went to get the wine, and the wine was gone.
Oh, so they had communion before communion.
That's what that was. The wine was gone, and she looking for the wine, and the wine was not there.
I hear you.
Everybody had drank the wine. I mean, we thought it was open for everybody. We didn't know it was for communion.
Oh my goodness, that is funny.
So we drank the wine, and she was upset.
That was funny.
So that was the communion. So we couldn't even do communion because she likes what my mother likes to do is for the new year. It's I don't want to say it's tradition, but you know, when church was open, when you would go to church on New Year, they would do communion, the communion service to bring in the new year
service,
and different things like that. So my mother called herself doing that. And it wasn't no wine.
Wow.
We thought it was open season, so we drank it. It was good, too.
Wow.
It was good. Because, you know, it was red wine. Because, you know, they say a glass of red wine
is good for your stomach,
is good for your heart and different things like that. So, man, we tore that wine up, and before we knew it, it was gone.
I hear you.
And, so
and wine make the heart merry, too.
Hello. Yeah. Hello. So we couldn't do the communion and different things like that. So she was a little upset, but we calmed her down because we went and bought some more wine. Thank you, ShopRite.
Oh my goodness!
Because you know some ShopRites they have the wine section. So we were able to go to ShopRite and get another bottle so that you know she could do her thing.
You know, it's funny. I remember one time being in church. And I think it was kind of centered around New Year's. You know, people like to drink wine to celebrate the New Year, bring it in and all that other stuff. And this one, I think it was like doing a Bible study or whatever it was. This one guy said, "Hey, Pastor, I got a question." He said, "Why would Jesus turn water into wine and tell us not to drink?" yeah, man. And the pastor couldn't answer the question.
I'm serious.
Yeah, it was funny. I just thought that was funny.
Make it make sense.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yes, I'm trying to figure that out, too.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
And not only that, he turned a whole jug of it.
Yeah.
What do you call it? A barrel?
Yeah.
He turned a whole barrel into wine.
Yeah,
from what I understand, it never went empty.
Yeah, I think it was one of those days where as long as they kept pouring, It kept turning into wine.
Exactly.
And guess what Jesus' mom said?
What?
She said, "Listen, whatever he say, do, listen to him."
That's right. That's right. We're going to turn up tonight. Turn down for what?
So they was turning up in the Bible too, man.
Yes,
so if
they
you
were.
Celebrated your new year, turning it up. Of course, we want you to, we hope that you
drink
remain
safe.
Yeah, we wanted you to remain safe and all that stuff. But if you listen to the broadcast, then we know you're cool. You made it home
and you're safe.
You know what I'm
saying? But listen, one glass of red wine, you guys, not three, four, five, two, three, four, five, six. It says one glass of red wine, not a big old glass.
Yeah.
A small glass of red wine is good for the heart.
That's it. Yeah.
Keeps it.
I mean, people don't drink it for that purpose, but that's it. Yeah.
And we're not
promoting drinking
by
no stretch of imagination.
But we want you to be healthy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, because they said it cleans out your blood or something.
Yeah,
something
yeah.
they were saying like that.
Yeah.
Find out. Y'all find out. I just want to make sure I'm telling you the right thing. But I did hear that one glass of red wine a night is good for your heart or something like that.
Yeah.
Well, but what did you do?
Well, for me, I didn't have communion with wine. But I did bring the new year in, you know, in prayer.
Nice.
And, so yeah, you know, everybody has their way that they like to set the tone, you know, going into the new year.
Yeah.
And as the clock was striking 12, you know, I wanted to be bringing the new year in prayer. And so that's what I did. And I also, you know, was working. So I wanted to bring the new year in praying and making that money.
Hello.
Because I want to set the tone for this new year. That
that's
the money,
right.
It ain't going to be funny, but it's going to be hitting my pockets, honey.
Hello.
I sound like a pimp, don't I?
Yes.
Anyway, so that's what
well,
I
wait did. A minute. Did you at least get the collard greens, the cornbread, and the black eyed peas?
No, I didn't do the big feast this new year. Mm-hmm. Traditionally, we would go over a family member's house. And it was actually a tradition that my grandmother started when we were little.
Okay.
New Year's, we would go up there. She would invite the poor people in, and everybody would come up there and eat. So we didn't do the family feast thing. So it was just one of those, you know, kind of like, you know, you kind of bring it
in. Well, you know what?
So,
don't worry about it, because I ate enough for the both of us.
Okay, okay.
Okay. I ate a portion for me. And I ate a portion for you.
Okay.
And we said, you know, double prayer. You were praying on your end. I was praying on my end. So guess what? Mm-hmm. We good.
Okay.
Because the Bible says where two or three are gathered, there I am in the midst. There you go.
All right.
So we covered. We covered. We covered.
Yeah, man.
With the wine, of course, but we were covered.
Yeah. We're covered. So, yes, but I actually missed those New Year services. Remember, you used to go to church, you go at 10 o'clock, and it would end slightly after. Mm-hmm. And it was just a tradition that started to just encourage and inspire people going into the new year for the preacher to, you know, kind of speak hope that this year is going to be better. And it was just to impute people with what they call an injection of exhortation. And so it was always good. But of course, you know, We learned that, hey, the church is everywhere.
Yes, we go. Yeah.
And so wherever you take your feet, you take the church with you. Mm-hmm. You're that representation. Mm-hmm. So whether you did it at home, and of course with the pandemic, it wasn't a lot of the services. You know, wherever you did it, you know, it was equally the same in terms of quality and effectiveness. Mm-hmm. And so that was real neat, man. Real neat.
Yeah.
I used to really enjoy those, and they would have a lineup of different preachers, and they would just, people would just, you know, it's just a, you know, some people just, that's that thing. They want to bring the new year. Some people want to bring it in a party.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
You know, some people want to bring it in church, in prayer. Some people want to bring it in prayer with friends and things like that. Mm-hmm. And so whatever, you know, whatever floats your boat or whatever's your steeds, as the rappers say, you know, hey, to each his own.
Yeah.
And we hope that it was a blessing for you.
We're all believing God for a better year than last year. But the thing is, we're not going to focus on last year. Last year is over.
Yeah.
It's over and done with. We're in a new year. And so what we're going to do is we're going to focus on getting better, being better this year.
That's it.
That's what we're going to do.
That's it. All right. But look, so we're going to take a break?
Yep, we're going to take a break. But before we do...
Listen.
Yeah.
Look, we got a director for your behind.
Yes,
as
Lord.
They say. Listen, he's a multi-talented, international, multi-award-winning indie filmmaker. I mean, he's that dude. You're going to enjoy hearing his experience. He comes out of a college. Hey, that's going to get you ready for the film world. He got a team around him that can bring it. From the director, the writers, the producers, all the way down to the actors and the cast and the crew. And, man, they do what they do, and they do it big. Man, don't go nowhere. Don't touch that dial.
That's right.
It's the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio. We are everywhere, and we will be right back.
Yeah.
another. I try to tell myself, but you can see it in my eyes. So don't deny, I can't fool no one else. The truth is in the tears I cry. Cause if it isn't love, why do I feel this way? Why does she stay on my mind? And if it isn't love, why does it hurt so bad? Make me feel so sad inside. If it isn't love, I told her I'd never fall in love, but now I know better. How does it feel? I can't describe this feeling that came when I saw her last night. Oh, she got to me. I let you know the reason. I saw her with another guy. So if it isn't love, why do I feel this way? Why does she stay on my mind?
Satisfy your sweet tooth with some tasty treats from the Brownie Shop. Fudge cupcakes, sweet potato pie, freshly baked bread, homemade ice cream, creamy chocolatey brownies, and much, much more. Check out their full menu on Facebook Brownie Shop or Brownie Shop 2019 Instagram. Get your next dessert from the Brownie Shop. your sweet tooth will love you for it.
Urban Elite Beauty LLC is an online urban beauty supply store that serves both men and women in urban communities. Our goal is to provide quality beauty solutions for our culture and community. Most importantly, we want to instill in our friends the importance of loving thy hair, loving thy skin, and to love thyself. Check us out on social media, on Facebook at Urban Elite Beauty, on Twitter at DBenton71, on Instagram at Urban_Elite_Beauty. And for more information, go to our website at www.urbanelitebeauty.com or email founder and CEO David Benton at DBenton@urbanelitebeauty.com or call 609-217-5292. Check us out and see what the Urban Elite Beauty experience is all about.
All right.
So We're back.
All right. So we ready for our special guest?
Yep. We are ready. Listen, our special guest is a super talented, international, multi award-winning indie filmmaker, director, writer, producer, actor, editor, and cinematographer who is making his mark on the world. Our special guest has coined his signature phrase for his films called a Mike Pender John. All in all, our special guest will, and is bringing it on set. He's a native of Philadelphia. Our special guest fell in love with cinema when he first saw the classic epic movie called Empire Strikes Back at the Midtown Theater at just 2 years old.
I am your father.
And after studying film and media arts at Temple University.
TU.
Yeah. Our special guest has gone into making over a dozen film projects that have been officially selected in over 50 film festivals across the globe.
Our special guest has gone on to win several awards internationally. These awards include, but are not limited to, the Silver Award for Best Short Film Subject at PhiloFilm, honored as part of Best of Fest at the International Black Media Film Festival in Oxford, England. He also won the Audience Award at the Pitton International Film Festival in St. Lucia and Best Short Film at the Filmmaker International Film Festival in Malaga, Spain for his dramatic web series, Swing. Because it don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. To date, our special guest has been selected for the prestigious The Greater Philadelphia Film Office Filmmaker Spotlight, not once, but twice.
Yes. His satirical short film about stereotypes of black men in America, The Negro Zone, was used as a headliner to tour the U.S. to different universities to discuss race relations in America. Limits are what you allow them to be, says our special guest. In 2016, The Negro Zone became a required viewing at the University of Wyoming in the Education Department for Diversity.
Our special guest has worked with top-tier talent like R&B icon Patti LaBelle, hip-hop mogul Jermaine Dupri, civil rights legend Bobby Seale, Sean Stockman of Boys to Men, and performance talent David Mann of the Tyler Perry franchise, Meet the Browns, just to name a few. Our special guest is an undeniable asset to any project, and he is that dude. But who are we talking about? None other than the magic man himself, Magic Mike, behind the camera, Mr. Mike A. Pender! Yeah. All right, Mike, how you doing?
Yeah, what's up, Chad? What's up, Nikki? Thank you guys for having me. I'm honored. I'm flattered. Happy New Year, all that good stuff.
Wait, look, you took the words out of our mouth because we were definitely going to wish you a Happy New Year.
Yes.
Thank you for taking time out your busy schedule to share with us and our listeners around the world, man. Yeah, we're so honored and glad to have you on.
Well, thank you. Like I said, I'm honored. I'm happy to be here. I mean, I'm a fan of the show, so, you know, I'm honored.
Awesome.
Well, that helps, man. That helps. Mm-hmm. You know, you get special privileges when you say stuff like that. On top of us having worked with you before. But, you know, that's just a side note. But anyway, we're going to jump right into this interview. So you ready to go? We're going to jump right into it?
We're going to jump right on in. So, So you are a filmmaker, you're a writer, you're a director, producer, actor. You do acting also, and you do editing. You're the cinematographer. You do everything. You got any help over there?
No, I got a great team.
You got a great team.
Yeah, like, I feel like if I start listing people, I'm going to leave somebody out.
Yeah. No. Mike, you sound just like me, man. I hate trying to call names because I know I'm going to leave somebody out. They're going to call you up. They're going to text you and say you forgot. But I like to refer to y'all guys as the Temple Squad.
Yes.
Yep. Yeah, a lot of us all went to Temple. Most of us met at Temple. You know, there's a few people like Jacoby, you know. Even though he might not want to admit it, Jacoby Simmons kind of like an honorary, you know, Temple alum, because he's been hanging around us so long, and you know a lot of Temple Sigmas and all that good stuff.
Okay, but, that's what's up.
Nice.
It kind of all started. I met my creative partner, Chief Pender, at Temple University in 1998 on a student film project.
Mm-hmm.
I was assistant director. / I played a dirty preacher.
Wow!
And, he was the supporting actor. The director wanted to talk to the lead actor. And at the time, my car was down, so he asked me to ride with our chief, who didn't want me to ride with him. And we was in the car. He didn't even talk to me at first. And then, he was a big Tupac head back then.
Okay.
He put on the Me Against the World album, and I just happened to mention it. I thought it was an underrated album. And ever since then, in February 1998, I ain't been able to shut him up because, you know, he called me or texted me or, you know, like every day, yo, we got to do this. What about this? Did you do that? We got to do this. So we've been rocking and rolling ever since. We've done stage plays that toured the United States, America, different colleges and universities, which I honestly never expected or even thought about. We've had films that's toured the globe. We even had one film that was used on a collegiate tour, a national collegiate tour.
Mm-hmm.
We basically way of four-walling, which is something I, once again, filmmaking took me, or creative art basically took me to a place that I never thought. Like, we've been to, University of Tennessee. We've been to Mega Evers in Brooklyn. We've been to University of Minnesota. We've been to Dillard, Tulane University, Xavier University, Virginia State University, all over the country. All the film. And it's now required viewing in an educational department at the University of Wyoming. And it's been that way for 4 years.
Yeah,
we initially started out with a $300 budget and a bunch of hungry, creative people from Philly.
Look, well, we about to nickname y'all the Harlem Globetrotters, or the Philly Globetrotters, and start singing that.
That's beautiful. Now, I heard that you got your love for film when you saw Empire Strike Back.
Yeah,
I'm a huge Star Wars fan. Let's talk about that.
Oh, that's good to hear.
Oh, yeah, I love me some Star Wars. I can sit and watch it like I've never seen it before, back to back at that. Yeah. No problem.
Like in college, I used to go to sleep watching Empire Strike Back.
Yup. Tell us about that.
I guess what happened was, you know, my mom was a sci-fi head, and she saw the original Star Wars, I guess, when I was a baby. But this time, in particular, I guess it was like May 1980, Philadelphia.
Mm-hmm.
There was no, she didn't have a babysitter at the time, and she really wanted to see the movie. So she took me downtown with her, which actually became like, I guess after this particular day, it became like our little thing that we did, you know, mommy and son. Because my mom plays a big part in my whole love for
film.
And it all started with my first trip to the movies when I wasn't even three. It was like a month before my third birthday.
Mm-hmm.
She took me down to Gordon Chestnut. Back then, it was the Midtown Theater. Now it's the Press Theater.
Right.
And I remember trying to get in there because, you know, my mom was young when she had me, and she still has a beautiful look.
Mm-hmm.
So they didn't want to let me in. And then I remember an older black gentleman, you know, kind of coming to the aid of my mom because there was, there was a single white mother. I don't know if she was single or not, but she was the only parent. She had two little kids who were about my age.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't think it was right because they didn't want to let me in because I was too little. But he was like, you know, you let them in, they're around the same age, and then they eventually let us in.
Mm.
And for me, the rest is history. Like, you know, I still remember seeing Darth Vader standing on the, you know, standing on the bridge talking to the bounty hunter.
Yeah.
It like forever. I still remember like seeing and being intimidated by like Darth Vader. I was like, oh, look at him, Paul, look at him. I fell in love with Star Wars after that. I fell in love with movies after that.
And, nice.
My mom used to take me to see movies downtown, whether it was the commercial zone at the Duke and Duchess, the Midtown Theater.
Downtown.
And then as I got a little older, it was the Martial Arts Movie Theater before the Trocadero right there on Arch Street. We used to go watch movies like Super Ninja and Five Deadly Grandmothers. Added to my love for martial arts, along with, you know, seeing Bruce Lee movies at home. And then later on, Philly 57 back in the day, y'all remember that? You said a Kung Fu Flick, and so did Channel 29 at one point.
All the same.
Man, you look, you Mike, you taking us back. And I'll add to that. Yeah, man, we used to go up to the Capitol on Gerard Avenue and watch the Kung Fu double features every Sunday. So, yeah, man.
I remember in the late 80s, it was a big deal when they reopened the Capitol because I saw Superman Crest of Peace.
Because
I was from North, but for some reason, my dad took that down.
Okay, let me find out. What do you think about these new Jedis? What do you think about the newer movies and the young man from England? What do you think about them in Star Wars?
I guess, you know, I'll be honest, I prefer, you know, the original episode 4, 5, and 6. I still think those are the best episodes. I know originally when it came out, it was just Star Wars, Empire Strikes Back.
Right, Return of the Jedi.
You know, he was like, my grand scheme was this, this, and that, so he remembered them. But those are still my favorite. I go back and forth about Empire and Jedi, but the original trilogy period still holds, you know, a big spot in my heart. You know, I didn't like the prequels that much. Well, I had issues with the original prequel that he did, which I guess later got renamed Episode 1, 2, and 3. But I appreciate them more because honestly, most of the ones that Disney did, to be honest, have been disappointing. Like, you know, I like Rogue One. That scene with Darth Vader at the end. You know, that made the movie right there for me. But, you know, I did love some of the newer characters that they had in there that they introduced. Force Awakens didn't really do it for me. Like, I was in, like, the first few minutes, especially the way they introduced Kylo Ren, appeared, like, and Han Solo were back, like, after that, to me, it all went downhill. The next two movies were, like, the worst two Star Wars properties, like, ever.
So, Mike, you studied film and media arts at Temple University. Now, we've done you know, some Temple student films before. One of the things that, you know, I realized working with the Temple students, like, they all support and help each other. You know what I'm saying? So my question to you is, how do you feel that studying film and media arts at Temple, you know, prepared you for what you're doing right now?
Tremendously. Temple helped me tremendously. Like, I was that dude who basically, back then, the film department was in Annenberg. I think somebody told me that it moved to the building across the street. Don't forgive me, I don't know the name. But, like, I lived in Annenberg, like, literally. And I was that dude, oh, you need help with film project last night. Like, I spent a lot of time helping people with their project. And probably next time I'm actually working on my stuff. But I built a lot of great relationships at Temple University. That's why a lot of time, you know, when I need crew and even cast to a point, I still got those people on speed dial. You know, I could always call and assist or just ask for advice and vice versa. Some of the big opportunities that I got, I've been blessed with my Temple connections. Like, I did the Sizzle Reel for Jermaine Dupri. Back in 2009, I got that because of the relationship from Temple. I was able to, you know, film some other projects because of my relationship with Temple. So, and then, like, the dude that I work with the Mr. IT Premier.
Yeah.
Our relationship and our bond started out at Temple at a student film project. And, you know, one of my mentors is Fred Thomas, one of the original What's Up Dude.
Yeah.
You know, which, you know, I can still pick his brain and everything else. And, you know, he even came to premiere for Computer Love all the way from Los Angeles to help support and everything else. So, you know, I love that. Temple is a great part of who I am as a filmmaker. They showed the Citizen Game, like, the class we had, but, you know, I love that whole Temple experience. I wouldn't trade it for nothing. I got to go back to speak at Temple in 2011, which was awesome. Especially considering, you know, I got a little ticket pass at school. you know, I think nowadays you don't have to go to college to be a filmmaker. We look at some of the greats like
Spike Lee.
Tarantino. Oh no, Spike Lee went to film school and grad school.
Right, no, but he said he did voice that you don't necessarily have to go to.
No, exactly.
Yeah, so he did voice that. Yeah, but like you said, Quentin Tarantino, definitely.
Yeah, Tarantino, James Cameron, like these are dudes are some of the biggest directors of our time, and they didn't go to film school. I'm not saying not to study your craft because there is a difference. You know, like Tarantino took classes on acting so he can work on his script writing and you know, trying to understand what made actors tick. And then, you know, you look at James Cameron, who was a truck driver, who would actually go to libraries and, like, print, like, books on filmmaking and read them, I guess, in his long road trip and study them back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
And then, because the key, too, no matter which path you take, is relationship. Like, I listen to some of the great directors, you know, like Spike Lee, who was a major influence on me, and I got to meet him a couple times, which is awesome. But, you know, Ernest Dickerson went to film school with him. And at the same time, he was there. Ang Lee was there and some other people. And then, you know, you look at George Lucas, and he was cool with Spielberg. And then Brian De Palma was the one who came up with having the scroll at the beginning of Star Wars. He was also a director friend of his. He directed his own movies. And then, you know, he kind of, his first job out of college pretty much in the film industry was working for Francis Ford Coppola at Dotro Films. So, you know, relationships is key. And that's why I'm thankful that I did go to film school because, like I said, relationships helped me out a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I know they say the director is the auteur of the film, but, you know, you still need that crew. You still need that band. It's always great to have somebody to bounce stuff off and everything else because, you know, I could probably go out here and make my movies, but I'm sure they wouldn't be the same if I didn't have some of the great people that I have supported me behind the camera as well as in front of the camera. So I'm thankful and I'm blessed of the talent and all the talent that I've got to work with. Like, I still love working with you, Kev.
Yeah, no doubt. No doubt, man.
You did an excellent job with that character, man. You brought more of that character than, honestly, that director and the co-writer that film that I anticipated.
Oh, thank you, man. Oh, man, thank you. I really appreciate that. And, man, for me, first, that's big coming from you. I remember Atif was the one that cast me, and, you know, for the role of Tugboat, man. And so, you know, I just listened. I followed his directives, and I got cast. And I just remember, man, we was on set. I think the call time was like around 5-6 o'clock. And we was grinding overnight, and the scene turned out really, really well. But that's big coming from you, man. Definitely appreciate you guys giving me the opportunity. And, I mean, while we're on the subject of Swing is globe-trotting right now. I mean, it's all over the place. And I think it's on, or rather heading to, last I heard, to Amazon Prime.
Yeah, we're working on getting it on Amazon Prime. I got to make some tweaks with the subtitles, but yeah. Once we get that cracking and rolling, we'll be up on Amazon Prime. And then you guys, if you haven't seen it before, check it out.
Yeah.
It's called Swing. It's a web series. Right now, there's 3 episodes. We got slowed down by COVID a little bit, but we still banging out what we got. We released the 3 individual episodes as its own standalone movies. We went entered in film festival basically from was it the Newark International Film Festival up in Jersey, all the way to a film festival in Colombia and Spain and the Caribbean at the Python International Film Festival, where we won a couple of awards. Well, we won an audience award there. We won an award over in Spain as well.
Nice.
first selection in like a lot of festivals, and I'm proud of Web Series Swing, which originally is actually based off of a stage play that I teach wrote years ago. And, you know, producers, Nikita Dillard, as well as actors, and Keith Ballard called me up and was like, yo, we need to shoot that joint. Joint's too good, not to, you know, just leave on the stage. And I was like, I agree with you, but, you know, Keith don't want to do it. So he was like, oh, get that joke on the phone. And then we got him on the phone, and we, you know, we told him what we spend, and, you know, him and I, who write a lot of stuff together, we got together, and we opened up the stage play. We added more characters like Tugboat, because he was in the original stage play. And we went from there, because once again, that was a stage play that we performed at the University of Maryland several times, Philadelphia University. I know they just changed the name recently again, but Philadelphia University a few times. We did with Mega Evers College in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. We did Virginia State with that as well. And University of Georgia, which was huge, because that was the biggest theater we've ever been in. Southern Connecticut University, you know, along with people who really actually enjoyed the play, and we just thought that the play lended a lot more to film or video, and that's what we did. And, you know, like I said, it's done well on the festival circuit, and soon if you haven't seen it already, you'll be able to see it on Amazon. So I'm proud of that.
Nice. Nice. Now, from all of the films and everything that you have been doing, you have a signature phrase for your films called a Mike Pender John. How do you come up with that name? How do you come up with that?
All right. So, you know, like I said, my mom, you know, took me to a lot of movies when I was a kid. And when I was about, I would say, I think it was about 11, she took me to see School Days.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was thinking Spike Lee, too. Spike Lee joint.
Yep.
Exactly. And she wanted to introduce me to, you know, black filmmaking. And she thought I was mature to handle it, because actually, the first time I actually had to talk to Spike Lee, I told that story. He's like, come on, did you see at 11? I was like, yes, we did at 11. You know? And I'm glad she did, because between that and just the world, the main reason why I like really got hit about going to college.
Wow.
I started my collegiate career at Lincoln University. I don't care what the team people say, it's the oldest historically black university. But, you know, the reason that I went to college, well, probably the primary reason I went to college was School Days. And School Days was one of the first movies, you know, one from being a lover, watching movies, to like, yo, because Spike did this, I can do this.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, Spike called his young Spike Lee joint. So I was like, yo, I'm so good. I'm going to get my credit film.
Yeah.
Nice.
And you know, Mike, I love it because John, that's straight Philly. You know what I'm saying? That's us. That's Philly. Like, we like, yo, you know, I'm going to the John, and I'll be back. Right. And, you know, we went to the John last night. You know, that's us. You know, they was even making fun of that slogan in the movie, what was it, Creed 1, when Tessa Thompson was trying. So that's straight Philly, man. That was a play on what we say. Mm-hmm. But I like it, man. It's a spinoff of, it, you know, it sounds like a spinoff of a Spike Lee joint, but it's an original. A Mike Pender John. So,
I like it.
Yeah, we had to put that on your promo. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? We had to put that on your promo.
Yeah, I appreciate
that. We look out, man. We look out.
Yes, I like it.
What happens in the future? I'm proud to say I'm from Philly. Like, and you know, when I went to England with the movies, or if I'm talking to somebody in California or whatever, like, I rep Philly hard. Like,
no doubt.
I remember one time we was trying to get like theatrical distribution for Computer Love. And I got the Hollywood Creative Director, which I don't think they make anymore because they got IMDb Pro. But I spent like what $70 to get this phone book of the Hollywood industry, and I'm calling up everybody to distribute my little movie, my little project. And you know, I call MGM and I leave them a message, and then I get a phone call from a California number like the next day.
Nice.
And I was like, well, maybe one of them people finally call me back. So I said, hello, this is Mike Pender speaking.
Wow.
I did the deep voice on them. And I can't remember the gentleman's name, but he said, yes, my name is such and such from MGM. You called me yesterday. I was saying, yeah, so I was actually calling to see if I could speak to you in your ear moment about this cool film project that I have a script for, and, you know, wanted to see if we can find a home at MGM. And he was like, oh, that's all great. But he was like, he said, can I be honest with you? I said, sure. He was like, I saw your phone number. It was a 267 number. And I was like, that's Philly. That's my hometown. He's like, that's the only reason I'm calling you back.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Wow.
Wow.
Small world.
You know, we got a little community out there in L.A. So, you know, fully strong, fully deep. There's been times where you travel the globe and people recognize the talent that we have here. Going back to my trip to England to premiere my short film, He Got Bills, you know, everybody was excited because this was like 2005. So our music scene was really hot back then. I don't know if y'all remember, but everybody was excited and asked me, did I know Jill Scott and Freeway and Soul Child and all the musical talents that was coming out of Philly at that time? And I was flattered, but I was like, no, but you know, Jill Scott did seduce me one time, but that's
fine. He said, he dish you out, yeah.
Wow.
That's what's up, man. But, you know, Mike, as I listen to, you know, your beginnings, you know, at Temple, you know, you reiterate something that me and Nikki talk about all the time on the show, that this is a relationship-driven business. And you never know who's who.
Yep.
From the janitor, from those in crafties, you never know what they're going to become. Like you said, James Cameron was a truck driver. Mm-hmm. So you don't know who's going to become who. That's why when we go on set, we be, you know, it's imperative that we're professional, treat everybody with kindness, whether they're the janitor taking out the trash, all the way up to the director and all that stuff, because you never know who you're around and how that relationship could culminate into something in the future. And just like people remember when you treat them bad, they remember when you treat them good. And, you know, we've seen so many relationships for us come full circle, get cast for stuff that we didn't even have to audition for because we did somebody right from our heart, from a genuine standpoint, and it resonated, man. And so you're just kind of, you know, like you're, as you tell your story, that theme, we keep hearing that theme about the relationships and relationships. And man, Temple has one of the best in the country.
Yes, they do.
Nikki and I are very familiar with Annenberg Hall. We done auditioned down there so many times. So when you say Annenberg Hall, it's like we couldn't find parking, but we made our way to Annenberg Hall.
Okay.
Yeah,
we know that place all too well.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, that's home. That Temple will always be home base for me. Philly will always be home base. You know, I'm proud of my roots. You know, I'm proud of, like I said, the town that's here in Philly. We got a lot of talent. You know, I like the fact that I can say that I work with you, Kev. I can also say that I work with Kevin Savage, who's doing big things. Who's doing big things. Nikia Dillard. That's like the mayor of Philly, unofficial mayor of Philly.
For real.
Brian Anthony Wilson.
B-A-W.
You know, Donovan Hagan's like, you know, like I said, I ain't want to start listening. I don't want to leave nobody out because the list is.
Charles Gregory.
That's my man going way back to Temple. Like,
yeah, you know.
I always thought he was a cool dude then, and then I got to work with him when He Got Bills or some other projects.
Yeah.
So, well, he's my man.
He was one of the henchmen on Swing, so we can't forget CG. Yeah, no doubt.
Now, you better stop naming names. You about to get phone calls.
You're going to get a phone call.
You better stop. You better stop. Why you say my name? You better stop. So what are you working on now? I know you got something going on in the vault now. What you working on?
Actually, I produced, directed a TV pilot called End of the Line with Nikia Dillard.
Okay.
He was the casting director. He was the producer. End of the Line. I think it's going to be a cool, dramatic show.
Oh, nice.
We post production with that. We literally just wrapped not too long before Thanksgiving. So with the holidays, we kind of took like a break and moved a little slow. But now the holidays over, we're gonna kick that joint in gear so we can get it up and running. Hopefully, out to the people by like March.
Nice.
You know, we're working on getting a swing on Amazon. I shot, edited a workout series for my partner, Keith Lanier. We're gonna be dropping that pretty soon. I co-directed with the Temple alum, a friend of mine, Angela Starkey. She wrote and produced, as well as co-directed, which I typically don't do, but we did a short film called Storage, which is the action piece. It's female-led action piece, which I'm proud of. We in post-production with that. Then we got Kitty U, which I was the director of photography, and I'm the editor on. We working on that. COVID kind of, like, stopped us, but, you know, we got to think outside the box and, you know, be resourceful on how we're going to get that out there, but I'm working on TU, which is directed and produced and written and starring Aisha Saran.
Okay.
Yeah, like it's, you know, and then actually, my brother and I got a project that we're working on. You know, I don't want to say too much because we still kind of, like, we don't take our time with that one. But that's going to be in a lane that I haven't traveled and I've always wanted to travel down. I got a meeting tomorrow about a, animated TV series I'm supposed to be part of.
Okay.
So that, and I'm just, as of right now, you know, I guess I'm like, I'll be like a director, writer, producer. So, and then, yeah, I got some other stuff going on the horizon. So I stay busy.
Awesome.
I don't know how I do it, but I'm blessed to have those opportunities.
Awesome, Awesome. Now, I want to kind of switch gears a little bit, man. Like, when I look at your work, you have a, I want to say a promotion or a celebration of African-American talent. And it's not that you are against diversity or anything like that, but your work in terms of what it speaks for itself has an African-American promotion, an African-American representation. You got your satire short film about stereotypes of black men in America called The Negro Zone. It was used as the headliner to tour the U.S. to different universities to discuss race relations in America. I wasn't shocked when I saw that. Talk a little bit about that, you know, because that's a very, very sensitive like topic to tackle in terms of putting on stage or putting in a film. But you did it all too easy, and I could tell it was something that was near and dear, you know, to your heart and the team. You know, why was this piece important in terms of the depiction of black men in America?
I'm glad you brought that up. But yeah, that was the piece that I was talking about earlier. Like, yeah, that little film, we started out with a $300 budget and basically just called in a bunch of favors. What happened was I always like the theme of everything is not as it seems or it's not as it appears. And, you know, as black people, a lot of times we're prejudged before people get to know us or we even get to say who we are. So that theme is like near and dear to my heart. And one of the first things that myself and my partner, Akeith Panier, you know, was able to collab on was the Negro Zone. And basically, I came up. Actually, I did a short film again, Project Greenlight, and it was called Intricate. And it was kind of basically about these four dudes sitting around a card table under, you know, one light, planning something that seemed devious, but in all reality, they were just all geeked about going to the midnight release at Tower Records in Lord of the Rings, you know. So, but from a distance, if you're judging them just by the look, you know, trying to judge a book by its covers, you would think that they were up to, you know, a robbery or something, but it wasn't anything that deep or devious. So he was like, yo, I like that. Can we, you know, expand upon that and do something else? And I was like, all right, cool. So we used to meet at my house when I lived in Germantown. I had this, you know, I lived in this huge house. And I used to have this little room. Well, it wasn't little, but I had this room. And we used to meet up there and we were just right. And I think we sat down and was it like 2 hours? We banged out a 12-page script. And we was happy with what, you know, and we basically just based it on what the average black male goes through in America, you know, with stereotypes. So we decided to make a satire out of it. I'm a big Public Enemy fan, so I wanted to call it Don't Believe the Hype. No, that don't work. Let's do something else. Let's play off the Twilight Zone and call it the Negro Zone. I was like, yo, that's a great title. It's going to be catchy.
Okay.
And I didn't even realize how catchy that title was until we got t-shirts printed up. And we went to Miami, and what we didn't anticipate, like everybody was involved in the project, that's how we went to the American Black Film Festival. Everybody who saw the t-shirts was like, yo, that t-shirt's great. Where can I buy one? And we was like, oh, wow. That's something that we didn't think about. And even sometimes walking down the street, like I would get people of all different ethnicities be like, yo, that's a great shirt. Where can I buy one? But that was a little film that could, we mainly only did the Negro Zone to get into APFF, which unfortunately we did not get accepted to APFF or Urban World. Matter of fact, the guy at Urban World, when he called me to let me know we didn't get accepted, he was laughing on the phone, so I didn't know how to take that. It was like, you know, it was like after that, though, while some people were dejected that my first two film festival submissions we didn't get accepted into, but that little film, all of a sudden, basically by itself, just started getting passed around from one film festival to another film festival. Like, we were getting selected in film festivals we didn't even submit. Like, I used to get a phone call from film festivals in Charlotte, in North Carolina, or different parts of the country. He was like, how did you get my film? And it was, oh, something gave it to me. And it was like, you had to have it in your film festival. And I was like, awesome, great.
Yeah.
And then, because we didn't get selected in the ABFF, I met a woman. Once again, you never know who you're around. I saw a black lady, an older black lady, with a cane and a white dress suit. I thought she was fly, but nobody was talking to her. So I just went up to this lady and started having a conversation. And, you know, next thing I know, this lady had worked for BBC. And she left BBC. She started her own film festival, which was the Urban Black Movie Festival in Oxford, England. And she was like, I have to have your film in my festival. And I was like, great. I'll bring my partner, my chief engineer, to discuss this later. She gave me a room number. And we came, went to the room late at night, you know, nothing but business in mind. Gave her the DVD, and it not only played at that festival, but played at another film festival over here, which changed my mind. But they loved it, so they actually invited us to premiere our next film, which was He Got Bills, which was kind of like a Spike Lee spoof, but you know, the importance of good credit in America. You know, we got to premiere that film over here, which was awesome, because, you know, I got to go over to England. They paid for my hotel room, most of my bills, and some other stuff, and like, I'm looking at a double-decker bus ride through Oxford, England, with my movie poster on the side.
Wow.
And my movie poster was the main feature at a program at the film festival, and I'm over there with a white producer who produced the film Justice, that had Roger Guinevere Smith, it had Monica Calhoun, who's from South Philly, by the way, it also had Kimberly Elise in it, and you know, they're looking at me, because people are, like, asking me questions, getting excited to see me, and they looking at me like, who's this dude? And one of the other producers who was there had produced, I think the film was called One Love. It had a young Idris Elba in it, Kamani Marley, and a few other reggae stars. And I'm at the table with these people. There was an ambassador to another Caribbean island who did a documentary on Caribbean life. And, you know, they're in different tax brackets than me, but everybody looking at me like, why can't everybody say what you do? They was basically like, who are you?
Yeah.
And I'm like, you know, I'm just Mike J. Pender from North Philly, made this little movie, and here I am.
Nice.
Like I said, film is taking me places that I honestly, you know, I haven't imagined. My dream was to hopefully one day make a movie and get it on the big screen. Quite haven't achieved that, but some of the other things that I've been able to accomplish, had my films on cable, local TV, and different film festivals across the globe, you know, to me, means a whole lot. Like I said, I never thought I'd be going to the University of Tennessee with my film, or, you know, any other college, University of Minnesota, where all other places that we went. Like, honestly, that was beyond what my concept of being a filmmaker was, and, you know, where it would take me. So I'm just excited to be on this journey, to continue on this journey, and I still believe, you know, bright things are ahead for myself and for the team that I work with.
Yeah.
Nice.
And, yeah, that's powerful, man.
Really nice.
That's very, very nice. Very, very powerful, man. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's one of them things where just because your film doesn't get accepted into a film festival, it doesn't mean that it's not good. Now, of course, being a director, it's your baby. You're going to take it, you know, personal. It's going to be a little sensitive. But sometimes when you make a movie, you know, because we're storytellers, that causes people to be confronted with truth or to be confronted with themselves. Sometimes they want to shy away from subject matter like that, you know? And so as you was explaining it, I'm saying, okay, this movie's good. It seems it was a possibility that there was a shying away of the subject matter. And, you know, it is a real issue for us as African-American males. Cause like when I'm dressed down 6'7", 240, I don't look like I'm a best film actor. I don't look like I'm an iHeartRadio show host. I don't look like that. I look like somebody who could be judged as being dangerous because of my height and my complexion. You know what I'm saying? I could be judged as being somebody that's up to something, you know, from a stereotypical standpoint. And so this movie and this subject is near and dear to my heart because I face it every day I walk down the street. You know what I'm saying? And I'm no criminal. You know, I don't have no criminal record. I've never been in jail. You know, I've never almost been in trouble with the law. And so that resonated with me. And I remember, you know, I follow you on Facebook. I follow your work, of course, when the pandemic hit and you was wearing a mask and they were saying, you can't go into the store without a mask. And you put a caption like, man, back in the day, brothers would have been arrested for doing something like this. You know what I mean? And I was like, yeah, I know, baby. You know, now we can't go into the store without a mask. Exactly. You know what I'm saying? So that was on point. That was on point, man. Yeah.
My health times have changed.
You know what I'm saying? We would have been coming out in handcuffs going into the store with a mask on.
For real. Crazy.
That's powerful. Yeah.
Now, my question is this, because like I said before, you're a writer, director, producer, editor. You do everything but crafties. I don't know if you do crafties, but you do everything but crafties.
Well, I got a story about that one,
but I was about to ask, do you do crafties too? Yeah.
I can, you know. When you're an independent filmmaker, you got to wear multiple hats.
That's it.
Yes, you do.
But I was going to bring it up because I'm not going to say this person's name, but I remember years ago when I was trying to, progress my career in film, mm-hmm. I had submitted my resume, and I had learned from my mentor, Fred Thomas, you know, hey, put Crash Hunters on there, because, you know, you never know how you can get on the set.
That's true.
And right. I put that on there, and there was somebody who tried to clown me because I had that on my resume. Like,
no. Wow.
But that's okay, though, because, you know, like I said, I've been able to do some things and make headway. And one of those people who was laughing at me came audition for one of my films. So, that, you know, that was vindication for me. That was enough vindication. Mm-hmm.
Well,
now you're
auditioning
for my stuff and you're
laughing
at me because I had craft services on.
Yeah.
Wow. So my question is this. You got so much going on and you have so much under your belt. For new writers, editors, directors, and different things, you know, people who are trying to, you know, break out in this business, are you holding like classes or are you teaching? Like, what are you doing a little bit to help the new people coming up?
I'm glad you asked that question. I'm actually, going back to when I was at Temple, I actually taught at a nonprofit at school program at Shoemaker. I did a class on filmmaking and I got paid well there. I got paid well for doing that program while I was especially for a college student. But to me, the biggest reward was maybe like 2-3 years after I had taught that class, mm-hmm. I had ran into one of the kids from that class at a Burger King. Mm-hmm. He was standing outside. He was like, Mr. Mike. And I was like, hey, man, what's up? How you been? And he's like, yo, I still don't know what a dolly shot is. And like, yeah, that really like was like music to my heart. Like,
wow.
I did an after school program with this kid. And to be honest, he wasn't the most attentive kid during the class.
Wow.
But I was able to get through to this kid and make a difference and make an impact. I don't know if he's doing film at all today. I don't even know if he still remembers, but the fact that 2-3 years later, not only did he remember my name, but he remembers some of the things that I was trying to teach, mm-hmm. educate, and expand their mind on. So that means a lot. But mm-hmm. continuing along, like I said, we did a college tour. So we talked about social issues. You know, we taught the kids to make sure that they speak up, let them know that, you know, be heard. You know, you have a voice and you're the leaders of the future. As far as actual filmmaking, I'm a resource. Like anybody who reaches out to me via social media, whatever, like I give them whatever knowledge I can share, you know, anybody who works with me will tell you, like, I have no problem sharing it. Like, mm-hmm. You know, whether I'm working with a first time director or executive producer, mm-hmm. which I have been lately, you know, I share whatever knowledge that I have. You know, there's a filmmaker named Rodell Brown who's in the process of making his first film, Twist of Fate, and he always calls me or IMs me or text messages me and he thanks me because I, you know, I've been talking to this dude about doing a film since 2002. Like, you know, he calls whatever and I give him whatever advice I can share and he's finally doing it. He's doing a crowdfunding campaign, wrapping up, getting his funding so we can make Twist of Fate, which I'm going to be his DP, but I helped him get his crew and plan in the right direction to get his cast.
Yeah.
And, you know, I gave him advice on how to raise money, how to market his film and everything else. And he's been doing nothing but showing appreciation because, you know, he said he talked to certain people in this area who he felt took advantage of him, mm-hmm. or, you know, like there was one person whose name, once again, I'm not going to say, you know, used a little bit of clout that he had to get him to take him to some fancy restaurant, and he stiffed him at the bill for the restaurant, and didn't really give him any information. You know, just dropped, you know, some big name people that he knew, but, you know, he didn't offer any true substance to help him and his partner, you know, progress with the filmmaking process. Yeah. And he said, you know, I've never did anything like that to him. He said he never has to worry about that. So he's very thankful. Like, the brother brought me a GoPro 1 year and, you know, showed me a lot of appreciation over years. Cause, you know, I don't know everything and I ain't perfect, but, you know, as long as you don't come, you know, incorrect, I ain't got no problem helping you out.
Nice. Well, not all sharks live in the water.
Yeah,
okay.
That's true.
I love that. I love that, Nikki.
And speaking of, I guess piggybacking off a situation like that, I mean, I know you keep your crew, y'all have known each other for years and years and years. So, you know, you can escape a lot of the dark side of the industry. Because, you know, you got people that, you know, come out of Temple with you. Y'all keep the same group of people. Y'all grind together. Everybody know each other. Y'all have relationship. But, you know, so I guess my question would be, we understand that, as you just explained, there is a dark side of the industry. How do you, what other ways do you stay away from it? How do you deal with it? What advice would you give to someone who may be a director, and when you get into it for your passion, you don't foresee getting stiffed, and you don't foresee, you know, people stealing your script. You don't foresee that stuff because you're getting into it for the love. So what advice can you give to somebody out there, you know, so that they won't be blindsided, to maybe prepare themselves for that dark side of the industry that's backstabbing, undercutting, lying, cheating, stealing?
Yeah.
All right. So, let me tell you, I've actually been through a lot of that. Who tried to steal computer love from myself and Atif, and that's when we, instead of, you know, going the route of trying to get Hollywood to come to us, that's when we just said, at this point, you know, we got to take whatever money we got, we got to make it ourselves. But yeah, there was a Hollywood producer who tried to steal it, and I guess he thought because, you know, I wasn't a big name person, I was at a film festival and I seen Hungry, and there was some talent there that, you know, he asked me to send him my script. He gave me his cell phone number. I had his office number. I even had his number to his crib. Like, and we were talking back and forth or whatever. So I was like, all right, yeah, I'm going to send you this and I'm going to send you that. And he was like, great. I got a first look deal with Universal. And, you know, I got a lot moving. I got a lot going on right now. But give me a couple of days and I'll get back to you. I'm like, all right. Cool, now I'm happy, and I'm like, yeah, we about to make this multi-million-dollar film, and we'll get this person and get that person, and then, you know, 3 days went by, and I didn't hear from him, and I'm like, yeah, we was going back and forth on the phone and email, like, every day, now I'm not here. So, you know, another day goes by, and I'm, you know, I got that, like, trying to do the okey-doke. So, I was actually, ironically, on the phone with someone from Temple University film department that I went to school with, and I'm telling them about the situation. And, you know, as I'm telling about the situation, that we both agreed, like, you know, there's some flim-flam going on, he actually returned my phone call. So I was like, here come the BS. Let me call you back. So I'm trying not to say the person's name. So I click over and I say, how you doing? Da-da-da-da. He's like, hey, Mike, how you doing? I've been busy. You know, I worked on that deal I told you about, and, you know, but my assistant got your script. I think myself, like, I answered to the assistant, I'll send it to you. My assistant got the script, and she was, she loved it. Oh, no, I'm sorry, hit me with the, do you want the good news or you want the bad news first? So I'm like, give me the good news first. Because I knew neither one was going to be good. So I was like, give me the good news first. You know, the good news is my assistant read the script, and she loved it, and she was so excited about it. She wanted to tell me about it, and I had to tell her stop. Because the bad news is, I'm working on a script really similar to it, but it's called Madison Avenue, and it takes place in New York on Madison Avenue, but she's sending me scripts.
Oh, my goodness.
And he got off the phone. So as soon as I got off the phone with him, I called a lawyer at the time. He was probably the biggest entertainment lawyer in Philly. I called him, and at the time, I had a cool relationship with him. Told him the scenario, and he was like, all right, keep all the emails. And he, you know, the phone bills to show where you called this person or you're going back and forth with this person. And if they come out with a trailer, we can legally go after them. But to that point, we can't do nothing.
Okay. Oh, wow.
Like, all right, cool.
That's good knowledge.
Fortunately, that person never came out with that film. They're still working in Hollywood, I believe. I haven't really checked on them lately, but they did produce a couple of mainstream films after that whole situation.
But it wasn't your film. Huh? It wasn't your film, though.
No, it wasn't my film.
Good.
Though.
Okay.
I was looking for that. So,
okay.
I would just say my advice, like you guys pretty much touched on, the industry that we want to be a part of is extremely shady. We can talk all day about stories of people who are deeper in the industry than me who've been taken advantage of. There's been a lot of well-known lawsuits from some movies that we love where people had proof or evidence that their screenplay was stolen. And then there's some people, you know, sometimes, no matter what evidence you got, you know, they don't even get that compensation back. Like, I heard a story about Movie for a Sunday. I'm not going to go into it right now, but, you know, it's a lot of shadiness in our business.
Wow.
And sometimes you can know a lot, but because we're eager to do things, people take advantage of that eagerness. And, you know, so just, I would just say, learn your craft as much as you can, especially on the creative side, but also on the business side.
Yeah, that's good.
Because, like, my partner, Chief, likes to say, you know, it's called show business for a reason. You know, it's a lot of cutthroats because everybody want to stay at the top of that business or get to the top of that business. They're willing to take out whoever they got to take out to get there or do whatever they got to do to get there. So, I had a mentor years ago who came to speak to Brooklyn University Black Student Film Collective, which I was a big part of. And that person said, you know, he talked about the underbelly back then. And he actually helped us out with another scenario that I got involved in on the ugly side. But he said back then, if you really want to be in this business, you got to decide where your morals lie. Because there are some people who will jump in the bed with people. We adults, so I'm going to be honest. Some people who jump in the bed with people. There's going to be some people, you know, might not be the same orientation as you who will try to, you know, coerce you to do other things to get what they want. You know, you got to decide morally where you are. Like, you know, so, and I've always tried to morally, like, you know, I never try to steal nobody's script or nothing like that. I feel like I got enough creativity in my mind. Anyway, I got stories that I'm sitting on that I can't get out fast enough. So
I never
want to try to steal somebody's script. Like I said, I try to help people in the past. It usually goes well. And even though McCoy, my circle, are my temple, of, you know, temple brethren and sisters, but, you know, our family, you know, our family circle has opened up to some additional people who didn't go to temple. You know, we don't hold that against you.
they just a distant cousin. That's all. They just a distant cousin.
Exactly.
That's it.
Exactly. Yeah. So, because we all try to get to the same place. As long as you can bring that same positive energy, and, you know, come aboard, you know.
Yeah.
And I appreciate that, and I love that. Like I said, there's a lot of talented, homeless people here in Philly. I've worked with some of these other filmmakers, whether I'm just being an extra in Shannon Newby's Heavy Sedation, which I was proud to be an extra in, or like me and Mike Dennis got to shoot for civil rights icon Bobby Seale. When he was trying to do a documentary, the fact that I got to work with Mike Dennis was cool, but the fact that I worked with Bobby Seale was even better. You know, and there's some other filmmakers, you know, they might call me up like, Mike, do you know where I can get this down person? Or Mike, can you do this? Or whatever. And I got no problem helping nobody, you know, as long as you ain't coming with that negative energy. Let's try our best to be there for each other and collaborate and, you know, everything else. So.
Yeah.
Nice. Okay.
That's what's up right there. That's it. That's good word.
That is.
That's good word right there.
That is.
Yeah. That's good word, man. Well, listen, Mike, man, this has been fun, man. And you've been a fantastic guest, of course. You dropped a lot of knowledge and experience on us and with us and our listeners around the world. I know whoever, you know, all the listeners tuning in are going to be able to take something from them, you know, that can help them in the industry and, you know, especially those that aspire to be directors and things like that, man. But you do great work. Keep up the great work, man. And you was already family, but as we say, we're going to go through the formality. But when you come on the Kevin and Nikki show,
you're family.
We got to give him the bell. You get the bell, brother.
Get the bell.
Yeah. Yeah, man. But yes. Yeah, man, before you go, man, in case somebody want to follow you on Facebook, social media, somebody might want to audition for you or whatever, this is your time, man. Somebody might want to hire you. Who knows? We've had that happen the show as well. So put your social media out there where people, if you got a website, where they can find you, they might want to invite you to some film festivals. Mm-hmm. We've had a lot of positive, strange things happen when guests come on the Kevin and Nikki show and put their social media out there, man. So this is your time, and go for it.
Oh, cool. I got to get better at this part. I believe it or not, sometimes I actually have to promote myself. on Facebook, I'm as simple as Mike A. Pender. On Instagram, it's a little bit more difficult, but once again, I'm a proud Philadelphian, so look me up on Facebook as Philly, Instagram as Philly Film Boo. I spell it P-H-I-L-L-Y. Film is P-H-I-L-L. Boo is B-U-H-L.
Okay.
At Instagram. On Twitter, Mike A. Pender, you can follow me there. I'm not that active, you can follow me there. If you want to email me, it's PhillyFilmBoo@gmail.com or MikePender1@gmail.com. So yeah, feel free to hit me up. I keep you posted on our projects, our castings, and everything else. Because a lot of times I don't really do my casting.
Right.
I keep them there, as well as the Kia Diller, and they love doing the casting part. So
yeah.
Casting, but you know, I'm the director usually or producer, so I can always be like, yo, look at that person. Yeah, so hit me up. Always looking for financiers and executive producers. But like I said, I got a lot of ideas. I honestly never thought I would come up with a horror concept, but I got several of those.
Nice.
Got some brood in my head, some sci-fi action.
Nice.
I want to do some animated projects. You
okay.
Know. I'll
let you go. All right. There you go. Yeah, man. Well, listen, man. Happy New Year again. Continued success and blessings to you, man. And we looking forward to, you know, working with y'all in the near future. Yeah, no doubt.
COVID,
yeah. Yes. Yeah. All right, Mike. Take care, man.
Thanks. God bless y'all. And once again, Happy New Year. Thanks for having me. I'm honored. It's been a fun hour.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for coming on our show.
No doubt. Yeah. All right, bro. Yeah.
Bye. Man, he was super awesome. Wasn't he super awesome?
Mike is that dude.
Yeah.
Mike is that dude, man.
He gave out that, listen, not all sharks live in the water.
Yeah, that's right.
You got to be careful.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because what he said remind me of that film I saw. Remember that Fame remake?
Yeah.
Where the young boy was an up-and-coming filmmaker. He was taking the film class.
Yeah.
And he found this guy over in the city. I think Fame was filmed in New York,
mm-hmm.
The remake. And he found this guy over in the city, and the guy was like, listen, you bring me $5,000, you know, in the camera equipment, we can do some things.
Yeah, yeah.
So he gave the man the money and the camera equipment, went back the next day, the dude was gone.
Yeah.
Took all his stuff, the money, the camera, everything.
Yeah.
Everything. You got to be careful. Yeah. There are always people out there who see the ambition. They see the drive that you got, and they will take advantage.
Yeah.
They will take advantage of it.
Yep. And that's why I'm glad, like, we hit on that, because we try to give people, you know, real, raw, but relevant,
mm-hmm.
you know, and balanced information, because, you know, you have a lot of aspiring writers, directors, actors who, mm-hmm. you know, they're going in it, you know, for, you know, the passion, the love, and to connect with positive people and to get on set and get in front of the camera or get behind the camera.
Yeah.
And they don't anticipate this other side. And, but I like how he summed it all up. You have to determine what your morals, your mm-hmm. values, and your standards are going to be. And, mm-hmm. And let that guide you, because, it is a cutthroat industry.
Yeah.
And, but he hit on a lot of things we always mm-hmm. talk about. It's a relationship driven industry. Yeah. You know, we talk about that all the time. You gotta be careful how you treat people. That's a life principle.
Mm-hmm,
but if
mm-hmm.
you take it into the industry, it's going to really, really help you out. Because, like I said, we've had projects that we've got cast for that we didn't have to audition for
mm-hmm.
because we treated somebody well 4 years ago.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And so you never know who you're around, who you're talking to. Like you talked about the lady with the cane.
Mm-hmm.
That would have been a person everybody would have least expected was somebody in the room. Yeah. And his, you know, the film festival, his short film ends up in the film festival.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why, man, when I go on set and you take the same mindset, we treat everybody with love and respect, whether you're the janitor or the person that's taking out the trash, or the person all the way up to the director, because mm-hmm. they might be a director on another set,
right.
but Crafty's on this one. Right. You see what I'm saying? Exactly. So you just exactly. never know, man. People around here, you know, acting like divas and mm-hmm. prima donnas and treating people bad and stuff like that. And we yeah. limit our blessings. We limit you our do. Opportunities. You do. And Mike hit on that. Yeah.
And I like what he said when he said that the Hollywood man, you yeah. know, tried to get his film.
Yeah.
And what he said was, you write it, you produce it, you direct it, and make Hollywood come looking for you.
Right, right, right.
I like that. Yeah. I like that. And that reminds me of the saying that you always say, mm-hmm. bring something to the team that the team needs.
That's it. And yeah. I got that from Will Smith.
Yeah.
Who I had a chance to meet.
Yeah.
And yeah, but make that, it's so profound. Yeah.
yeah,
because you want to produce a product that would make people look at it and drool mm-hmm, over it. Mm-hmm, it's mm-hmm. just that when some of them start to drool over it, they start to have bad intentions
exactly.
on how to take exactly. it, take it, take over it. And what I would encourage people who are script writers, mm-hmm. This might be something elementary, general, and profound. Get your stuff copywritten.
Yes, Lord.
Make the investment yes, to get your Lord. Stuff copywritten so somebody can't steal your stuff.
Yes, Lord.
You know what I'm saying? Because there have been many scripts that people mm-hmm. have, hey, submitted to this for review. They never saw it. Mm-hmm. Then the next time they saw it, it was on the big screen.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Yep, you better look at LegalShield.com
yeah.
and get your stuff covered.
Yeah, they got LegalZoom, LegalShield.
LegalShield, all of it.
And if you don't have the money, do the ghetto, what do they call it,
ghetto way.
Where you mail it to yourself.
Mail it to yourself, yeah. but still.
Yeah.
Pay that $35.
Yeah.
I think it's copyright.com.
Yeah, copyright.com
is pay that $35 and get that thing copywritten, because yeah. you even get a certificate
right, right.
in the mail that you got this film
yeah.
copywritten, and it has a date, a little copyright seal. Yeah. All of that is
on
there.
And you get a number.
And you get a number. Yeah. Pay that money and get it copywritten. So yeah. that way anytime you submit your film to somebody and you see that thing up on the big screen, you ain't got to worry about it. Just call yeah. your lawyer. Lawyer up. Didn't that happen with that woman from The Matrix?
I think it was The Matrix. And to my understanding, and we're not trying to throw shade on nobody at all, but to my understanding, there was a scenario similarly with The Matrix and Terminator. Mm. That Terminator and The Matrix was written by an African-American woman. So I'm not here to suggest anything. We're not implying anything. But we're just going to say the part that we do know is that Matrix and Terminator was written by an African-American woman mm-hmm. that ended up with major lawsuits. Mm-hmm. And to my understanding, she got paid handsomely.
She
won that lawsuit.
Yes, yeah. She won that because they stole that, right. okay? And okay, so
Nikki,
she got
Nikki, paid. See, Nikki don't mind saying
it. I don't mind yeah. saying it. She won it because they stole it, and she got it. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so more of this story is get your stuff copywritten.
Yeah.
That way, when you see it up on a big screen, lawyer up.
That's it.
Call my lawyer.
That's it.
That's all you have to say.
That's it.
Very good interview.
And when you utter those phrases, people tend to fall in line because
that's right.
at the end of the day, people in productions don't want to be sued.
Listen.
You know?
Listen, all you have to say, I'm going to call my lawyer.
Yeah,
it's all right.
Yeah.
Call my lawyer. You'll be hearing from my legal team.
Yeah.
When you say that, that means business.
I go a step further on Monday.
Okay.
You know, you got to add that part. You gotta hear that. You know what I'm saying? You got to say that part because then they know what time it is.
Okay. Yeah. And if you want to put a little threat behind it, you got 24 hours to fix it.
Yeah, that's it. That's it right there.
Yes, yeah. Pay that money and yeah. legalize your stuff.
That's
that way you ain't got to worry about it. Yeah. Pay that money.
I'm telling you, man, that shout out to that Temple.
Oh,
student,
yeah.
Student. Mm,
they get the bell.
Yeah. We got to give a shout out to that Temple student film crew, Temple University,
yes,
period, man. They are like a close-knit group
yes,
family.
They are.
They help each other. They have passion. They enjoy what they're doing. And, yeah, they all want to see mm-hmm. each other succeed. And here it is again. You never know what, boom operator or director
yeah.
will end up blowing up, and they start pulling Temple
yep,
folks up.
Yep,
and that's what they
yep,
do.
But
I like what Mike said. Well, we open to other people, though. We're not going to hold it against the name of Temple. You know what I'm saying? We open.
Okay.
But that core, that nucleus, man, them dudes is tight.
Yes.
And they like family. And, yeah, they...
We got cast for plenty of stuff
yeah,
coming out of Temple.
Yeah, yeah.
We got cast for so much stuff from Temple Student Film, they email us stuff anyway.
Hey, we
having this audition. We want you all to come.
That's it. They sure
you know what I mean?
Sure
we just get recommended for stuff. We've done audition for them so much, and we've been in so many Temple Student Films. Yeah. It's beautiful.
Yeah, that's really awesome. Good interview, man.
Yeah.
And Mike and his crew, Mike is that dude, man.
Yes, he is.
Mike is that dude, man. I mean, you know, listen, I mean, he like I want to say Spike Lee 2.0, you know what I'm saying? He like Spike Lee 2.0, you know, and that was one of his inspirations. And I know, you know, when he had the chance to meet him, that, but you know, when you saw that, a Mike Pender John, I was like, he Philly-ized that John. I was like, I'm feeling that. But that was great stuff.
See that on you know how when Spike Lee movie come on, it says a Spike Lee joint. Spike Lee joint.
Yeah.
I can't wait to see Mike Pender stuck up. A Mike Pender joint. Like, okay, this is about to be good. Yeah. Here we go.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Yeah.
All right.
All right. So we're going to take a break.
Yep. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, it's going to be time for news and sports.
Oh, the same, why can't we
Scholars Professional Editing Firm consists of a specialized group of academic doctors, editors, and statisticians that keep doctoral candidates moving through the academic doctoral process. The Scholars Group accepts doctoral dissertations, capstone projects, premise, research studies, research proposals, and oral defense preparations and presentations. The Scholars offer both qualitative and quantitative research assistant data analysis, dissertation editing, writing support, and mentorship through their bootcamp 8-week online program. The Scholars Professional Editing Group will keep you moving. And for more information, visit www.thescholarsediting.com. That's www.thescholarsediting.com. Or contact Dr. Tamika Haynes at 281-315-6053.
All right. So now it's time for news and sports.
All right, in sports.
Uh-oh.
It was all she wrote.
I know what you're going to say.
Eagles lose season finale to Washington on Sunday Night Football. Frustrating season ends. The Philadelphia Eagles lost to the Washington Football Team 20-14 in the final game of a frustrating season. The Eagles finished their 88th season 4-11-1 after a grotesque 20-14 tank job loss to Washington. The Eagles' season came to a merciful end Sunday night in an embarrassing fashion. With draft position being the only thing at stake, the Birds opted to rely heavily on unproven young players, and that reliance only worsened as their 20-14 loss to the Washington Football Team wore on. Jalen Hurts was eventually benched in favor of a third-string quarterback, Nate Sudfeld, who struggled to generate much offense production and turn the ball over not once, but twice. The defense played Rudy Ford, a safety at cornerback, all game, and decisions to go for it on fourth down oftentimes didn't line up with either conventional wisdom or analytical recommendations. The Eagles will finish the season 4-11-1 and will pick the sixth pick in the NFL draft, putting an end to a year that will likely be remembered as the season everything fell apart for Carson Wentz, or when Carson Wentz wrong.
Wow.
It's expected to be Jim Schwartz's last game as the team's defensive coordinator, and more coaching changes should follow. It might also have been the last game in Eagles green for players like Zach Ertz, Jason Kelce, and Brandon Graham. But here's the twist. Here's the twist to the Eagles game.
Okay.
The Giants, who we hate, along with the Cowboys, needed the Eagles to win to make the playoffs. So Giants players were unhappy with Peterson's decision to take Jalen Hurts out and put a third-string quarterback in who kept turning the ball over.
Wow.
So the Giants were big Eagles fans tonight, and several of their players didn't like it. Doug Peterson's decision to put in the backup quarterback in a one-possession game. The decision looked even worse when Nate Sudfeld had two drives and returned it. So the Giants players were treating, come on, man. What you doing? Can you imagine the conspiracy theories that are going on when the Eagles are playing the Washington Redskins, the Washington team, not Redskins, because they changed it due to... When the Eagles are playing the Washington Football Team, the Giants are watching. They need us to win to make the playoffs. We hate the Giants and the Cowboys. Doug Peterson puts in a third-string quarterback, taking out the second string with a one-possession game. The conspiracy theories are flying that this was intentional, this was in purpose, this was on purpose, and the Eagles may have been hoping to lose the game. And you know what? If that be the case, I ain't mad at them, because we hate the Giants and we hate the Cowboys. So I want to give the Eagles the bell for losing.
Okay, but hold up now.
So wait. So had they beat the Washington Football Team, they would have stopped them from making the playoffs. But even in a loss, the Eagles were so good in a loss that they stopped the Giants from making the playoffs. So, I'm happy about it.
Okay, so the Eagles lost, so the Giants can't go.
So they can't. So our loss kept the Giants out. That's why we giving them the bell.
I'm sitting here like, wait a minute, this math is not adding up. Something wrong with this count.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they're sitting back watching us, rooting for us, for a change all of a sudden, because they need us.
They need us
to win to make the playoffs.
Oh, okay, so y'all using us.
Uh-huh.
Okay, uh-huh. No, we ain't got nothing that, we ain't doing that.
And shout out to Dougie P for putting the third string quarterback in to lose the game. Yeah.
Okay. Well, Eagles, guess what? You did your job.
You did your job.
You still did your job.
We didn't stop watching it, but we stopped somebody.
We stopped somebody from going. Okay, listen. If we ain't going, you ain't going neither.
That's it. You know what? You know, when I first brought this on, I said in sports. I should have said in sports. That's all I got in sports.
Nice. Okay, Eagles. Okay. Happy New Year. Well, in news, somebody vandalized Mitch McConnell's house. Oh. And they didn't steal anything. They just wrote, "Where's my money?"
Oh, my
goodness. They wrote, "Where's my money?"
Oh, where's my money? That sounds like a pimp wrote that.
I don't know who wrote it, but they had a few words for Mitch. Okay. Where's my money? Because, as you know, Nancy Pelosi and Trump tried to get everybody the $2,000, but it was stopped by Mitch. It was stopped by Mitch. Mitch did not want to give out $2,000 to everybody, but Bernie Sanders has been burning up social media, putting Mitch McConnell's behind on blast because Mitch McConnell gave a wide chunk of money to somebody else, and Bernie was like, "How you going to give money to them and you ain't taking care of your home?"
Yeah, how about that?
You ain't taking care of your people, meaning, you know, the United States. I'm assuming that person is not from the United States. How you going to do that and you ain't taking care of home?
Right.
You got people who are out of work. You got people who unemployment have cut off, and you trying to, you know, scam them on $2,000, and you only going to give them $600? So Bernie Sanders has been on Mitch McConnell's behind, burning up social media. He's been on CNN. He's been talking about it to everybody who will listen. And so they took and sprayed on his house, "Where's my money?" Because about now, everybody must, some checks are still rolling out.
Yeah.
But everybody is still patiently waiting. Well, not patiently waiting. Everybody is still
eagerly waiting
their $600 to hit their account. But Nancy is still trying to get the rest of it. Okay. And they even spray painted on her house. Now, why y'all going to spray paint on Nancy's house? She's in favor of the
$2,000. Right.
Come on, get yourself together. You don't spray paint on the house who's trying to get you something.
That's right. Don't bite the hand that feeds
you. Come on. Get it right. No, we don't want you spray painting on anybody's house. But
we are promoting vandalism and violence. However,
okay, don't do Nancy's house, okay? If you're going to put something on the house, put some Zig and Nancy or something like that. Yeah. Don't spray paint her house. But listen, this whole thing is ugly because now we'll have more on this next week when we get the toll come in, because now Georgia is the state for the votes. We'll talk more about this next week, because I know that on Tuesday, the votes had, you know, everybody had to get out and vote and different things like that. So we'll talk more about that next week. Mm-hmm. And we'll go into depth about that and see what happened, because from what I understand, if the Democrats control this part, we good.
We good. It empowers our decision-making power in the United States.
Yes, and then everyone's getting ready for January 20th, and you know what happens January 20th.
Mm-hmm.
The inauguration. Yeah. And although we're in the inauguration month, Trump is still trying. He's still trying before the 20th get here to overturn. He even made a phone call to somebody over in Georgia to try and get them to throw some things out. And that was recorded. And they've been playing that thing all over social media.
Wow.
They've been flooding that thing with, they've been flooding that message on social media. And everybody's been talking about it. This thing has been messy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll talk more about that next week.
Yeah.
That's it.
That was enough.
That's all I got.
That was enough, man.
Lord have mercy. Even going into the new year, we got drama, people.
We got drama for your mama.
Yes, indeedy. That's it. That's all I got. So you know what? We're going to take another break.
All right. So we're going to take a break. And when we come back, it's going to be time for my favorite part of the show. We're going to find out what's bothering Nikki. It's the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio. We're everywhere, and we will
be right back.
So now it's time for my favorite part of the show. We're going to find out what's bothering Nikki. What's bothering you,
Nikki? Man, listen, I'm so excited. Let me tell y'all, I went to the dollar store, and I got my dry erase boards. I got my easel. I got two, okay? I got one for my ideas, and I got the other one for my vision board. Mm-hmm. For my vision board. And let me tell you, I've been working on that thing. I am super excited. The little $600 check didn't even bother me, you know, because I've been working on my vision board. Remember, I told you guys last year that I got some new things going on. I'm writing and different things like that. And man, let me tell you, I'm having a ball. I'm having a ball. So nothing is bothering me this week. Why? Because I'm in my zone. Rihanna said, take it to another level. And so that's what I'm doing. I'm taking it to another level. She says, step up and take it to another level. That's what she said. She said, this year, she said, forget about last year. She said, this year, everybody needs to step up to the next level. And that's what I'm doing. Step up to the next level. That's it. That's it. That's all I got. And let me tell you something, Kev. Everybody has been enjoying your high vibrations to the point where D-Nice, for those of you who don't know who D-Nice is a DJ who has taken over Club Quarantine. He's been keeping everybody grooving and everything like that while we've been in quarantine. D-Nice has been using your slogan.
Really?
Yes, indeed. I could not wait to tell
you. Wait, operating on high vibration?
High vibration, baby. D-Nice is like, we want high vibrations only. He said, that is our slogan for 2021. We don't want nothing dragging us down. He said, high vibrations only.
That's it.
And I said, wait till I tell Kev.
That's it.
Wait till I tell Kev. That's what we live in, baby. High vibrations.
Because his name is D-Nice, and he's taking out the suckers that you don't know how he did it. His name is D-Nice. His name is D-Nice.
There it is.
His name is D-Nice.
He's taking out the suckers and he don't know how you do it. Yes. He is on that high vibration. I said, wait till I tell Kev.
That's what's up. That's what it's about.
He is using it. He said, listen, forget last year. Yeah. Everybody is saying that.
High vibration?
Yes. Everybody is like, forget last year. He said, last year is over. Yeah. He was like, we are on high vibrations. Rihanna was like, we're taking it to another level.
Right,
it has been nothing but positivity.
Yeah, we've been saying it for almost 2 years.
We sure have.
91 weeks, so 52 weeks in a year. So
you better do the math.
We've been doing it for almost 2 years.
Make that math add up.
Oh, yeah. I'm funny.
Okay, we got a mathematician up in here. Make it add up. Make it make sense. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So that's what we are. Listen, I'm going to encourage you, our special guest. Listen, you want to write? Right. You want to direct. You want to act. This is where we are this year.
That's it.
No more nonsense. This is where we are. High vibrations only, and we're taking things to another level.
That's it.
That's all I got. That's it.
All right, so we're going to take another break?
Yeah, y'all. We're going to take another break, and when we come back, high vibrations only. Kevin's Corner, when we come back. It's Kevin Nikki Show on iHeartRadio. We are everywhere, and we will be right back.
Y'all know what this is. My mind was shaved. I'm glad you made. Intoxicated. Devotamate. Good love in the end, baby, you know. In the rush, you've been at it where the time goes. You going to show me now? Too many dishes, and I know that you feel me the way I am. And feeling you, and it's cool that you got a motive, and I think I like it. I know all your insecurities. I hope that you're open. My body gives notice that I won't show energy. Girl, give me that.
Don't be timid when you're in it, better lay back. I know you wanna go there, I see it, so front. Come there, I know you can drive it, chauffeur. Anticipate your touchdown. Come put me down like right now. Let's be lovers and friends. Let's
for the taking. I'm no further. I got what you need. Baby, I'm open. Got my attention. Undivided. Oh, baby, come on, give me that.
No question. Reach out to me. Touch me. If I have it, don't touch me. Just don't waste my time. No question.
No question.
About the quarter, I ain't here to play around. Ladies, if you're here with somebody and you know you want, they got it gone. Let them hear you say it loud.
Boy, it's about to go down. Yo, what you saying? Come and show me now. Fellas, if you're with somebody and you know you want that body, then let me hear you say it loud.
Good love, no question. Reach out and just touch me. I have it, don't touch me. Just don't waste my time. Loving, no question. Reach out, just touch me. That happens, don't touch me. Just don't waste my time.
You're listening to the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio.
All right.
So now it's time for Kevin's Corner.
All right. So listen, we've been keeping the high vibration going for 91 weeks because we're in week 91 and we're still dealing with signs that one is operating on a high vibration and frequency in life. You heard what Nikki said. We're taking it to another level. That's it. So I got two more characteristics. We got number 148 and 149. Wow. So since it's New Year, we have a New Year theme, high vibration, but it's going to all tie in. And see, this is how I know I'm saying what I'm supposed to be saying when it is tying in with what everybody else is saying. Mm-hmm. And they didn't know what I was going to say, and I didn't know what they was going to say. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, we saying what we said. You know what I'm saying? So characteristic 148 is a New Year's resolution / changing our thinking.
Yes.
So a New Year's resolution is a promise a person makes for the new year, regardless of what resolution you commit to. Mm-hmm. The goal is to improve your life in the coming year. So resolutions can come in many forms. Some people make a promise to change a bad habit, such as quitting smoking or eating less junk food or exercising more, etc., etc.
Mm-hmm.
But if we don't change our thinking about what we are trying to change, we are wasting our time and or it's all a matter of time before we regress back to our old way of living and existing. However, if we change our thinking in a positive way, and the key is a positive way about what we're trying to change in our lives, then that will cause us to feel different about what we are trying to change, thus speak differently in a positive way about what we're about to change.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm saying in essence is, positive thinking is going to affect how we positively feel.
Yeah.
And then it's going to cause the two positive thoughts and feelings cause us to speak positively.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
So next characteristic, second characteristic, New Year's resolution / changing our behavior. So once we change our thinking in a positive way about what we're trying to change, which causes us to feel different in a positive way about what we're trying to change. Stay with me. Thus, speaking differently, as I just said, in a positive way about what we're trying to change becomes the end result.
Mm-hmm.
And the end result will be positive change behavior. Because whatever you think in your heart,
mm-hmm.
you're going to speak, mm-hmm. and it's going to become your behavior. All right?
That sounds like a Bible verse.
It sounds close. So whatever man speaketh in his heart, there so is he.
That's it.
To get right to it. So now get this stat. On average, 80% of New Year's resolutions fail by the second week of February. I'm going to read it again we in church. Because y'all ain't hearing me. You know what I'm saying? Because y'all ain't listening. Ain't nobody saying it.
Preach, preach.
Uh-huh. On average, 80% of New Year's resolutions fail by the second week of February.
Mm-hmm.
Good habits, especially ones drastically different from typical lifestyle, are hard to get started and even harder to keep. Research shows that on average, it takes approximately 66 days for a habit to become automatic. Mm-hmm. And it starts with changing our negative thinking to positive thinking about what we are trying to change. Then we will demonstrate positive feelings mm-hmm. and positive speaking about what we're trying to change. And the end result will be positive change behavior on New Year's resolution fulfilled nice. Because it becomes your lifestyle. That's all I got. Nice. Man. Happy New Year to everybody.
Happy New Year.
Change your thinking. Change the way you feel. Change the way you speak. And it'll change your behavior. And your New Year's resolution won't just be a New Year's resolution. It will become a lifestyle.
That's right. That's right. That's right. Yeah. All right. Put it out there.
All right. So we want to wish you guys from Kevin and Nikki Show Land.
Yes.
Happy New Year. And we are excited about the coming year. And it's going to be way better. It's mm-hmm, going to be way better. Mm-hmm. You know, it's going to be way better. So we are excited about what's coming up. We're going to have more exciting guests as we've mm-hmm. been for the last, 4 years?
Yes.
So we thank y'all guys for riding with us, tuning in each week. As long as y'all keep tuning in, we're going to keep bringing y'all hot shows, hot guests, hot topics, and much, much more. Listen, you guys are on our mind. You guys are on our hearts. You encourage and inspire us, because the more y'all tune in, the more we want to keep it coming. So you guys are in our thoughts and prayers, and we love you. We do what we do for you, and we can't do what we do without you. I'm actor Kevin D. Benton. You can find me on Facebook, Kevin D. Benton, on Twitter, at Kevin D. Benton, on Instagram, actor Kevin D. Benton, and you can find us on YouTube, actor Kevin D. Benton, and actress Nikki Warren.
Yeah, you can find me on Facebook, Nikki Warren, on Twitter, at Nikki Warren, and on the gram. Hello, I'm Nikki. That's spelled HELLOIMNIKEE. You can find our show, The Kevin Nikki Show, on Facebook, at Kevin Nikki Show on Twitter, and The Kevin Nikki Show on Gram. And if you have any questions, comments, concerns regarding our show, hit us up, KevinNikkiShow@yahoo.com. You got any questions, comments, concerns for our special guest?
Mike A. Pender.
Hit us up, KevinNikkiShow@yahoo.com. We'll read it to him, get the answer, and read it back. And like we say every week, who knows, your letter can be featured on our show. Listen, high vibrations only, and we are taking it to another level. That is our focus this year. Forget everything else. That's where we live in this year. When anybody say, how you living? I'm on high vibrations only.
That's it.
It.
We're the Captain Nikki Show on iHeartRadio. We are everywhere, and we are
out of here.
Peace.
You just don't know what you do to me.
Bad. Give me all the chicken heads from Pasadena to Medina. Bet big, get in between your dentists. The prognosis, doses, blends and bends like Twizzlers. Biggest fitness to hurt, what's under that skirt? Who filling them with octane? Got them gassed up, about to get blasted up, son. The last one, heard the mother, brother, miss him. I seen it when he kissed him at the wake, made his body shoot. The high guy, it ain't 50 eyes, smoke, tank, rap, terror, four chrome, and terror. Shoot like five by the rivers, the fifth is conspicuous. Bad boy, sick to 95, ridiculous. My rap lines is like landmines. One step, kaboom, black suits fill the room. To whom it may concern, Junior Mafia is the click. Act up. I have my honey's total bustle.
That's right.
In the middle of the day now, baby, I seem to think of only you.
That's right.
Oh, can't you see you and me?
been listening to the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio.